Good evening, church. Just stand together.
Continue our time of worship in the Word. Let's stand together, and I invite you to join me in this combination passage. Genesis 1, 1, John 1, 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Genesis 1, 1, John 1, 1 and 2. All right, now before we launch off into this great classic hymn, great Methodist hymn, take a moment to hello those that are there around you. Let them know you're grateful to see them in worship tonight. Then let's sing together.
Thank you.
Pray together. Father, we are grateful that you are our Redeemer, our Rescuer, our Deliverer. You saw us when we were trapped, tied up, in bondage, couldn't extricate ourselves from all of those things that had us in its grip. And you loved us enough to make a way. You provided the power. You provided the price. You provided the dynamic to break those chains, to tear asunder those bonds, and to give us freedom. Freedom to become. Freedom to live. Freedom to serve. Freedom to love. Freedom to be that person that you have created us to be. Help us, Father, when we lose sight of that and we are willing to place ourselves back under the influence of, the power of things that drag us away from you, that take us away from that loving relationship. Father, open our eyes and help us to see truth, not to be deluded, not to be seduced by the enemy, but to see clearly those choices we make that take us away from you. And I pray, Father, that we remember that passage. It reminds us if we confess our sin, you, God, are faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I pray that we would have that humble spirit to bow before you and to acknowledge, yeah, we have, we are, and we want to be freed, we want to be cleansed. Father, bless us as we worship you tonight. Let this be a time of worship that'll be a pleasing sacrifice before you. We ask it all in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen.
There's a beautiful hymn that we don't sing that often, but it's just an incredible message, and it is from the psalm that we're singing that Brother Clint's going to bring tonight. I ask Christy to sing that first verse, and then we're going to join in just this moment of quietness, a moment of worship. Great hymn, Be Still, My Soul.
Cross of grief.
some passages of Scripture get relegated to certain settings. They just seem to fit better. And as I began to plot my course through the Psalms, these songs of life, there were some that kind of jumped out and seemed almost unavoidable as we make our way through the collection. And then this one is one of those for me. And I've preached this psalm before, so if you make notes in your Bible, I already know you've got a date in there. Okay, don't freak out. I'm not suffering a moment where I don't remember what I've preached. I know exactly what I've preached. But I thought that as we're making our way through this course of songs, it just wouldn't be right to skip this one. Now, I will tell you that more often than not, this passage of Scripture is one that I use in a funeral setting because it just has particular application. And I go back frequently to make sure that I haven't been guilty of just injecting it with the meaning that I want it to have and skipping what it really says. And I don't think that I have done that, nor that we will do that together tonight. Songs of Life. I tried to come up with the longest sermon title that I've ever had, and I may have come close. Just when you thought you had it figured out. The reality is that our human nature is such that we enjoy routine. We like, I don't care if you're a young person, a little fella, or you're an old geezer, we enjoy our routine. And there are certain things that we're going to do on the same day, at the same time, over and over and over again. Let that sink in for a moment. There are certain things that you do at the same time, on the same day, day after day after day. Unless something disrupts your routine, and then your day is ruined. Okay, so you're thinking with me? Without saying too much, without telling me things that I don't want to know and that will keep me awake tonight. What are some things in your routine that if you told me tonight, I could come check on you and without a doubt, you would be on that day at that time doing exactly the same thing? And Chris, you're pointing at your husband. And so what is it? Can you say? Not oatmeal. Many wheats, a bowl of many wheats every morning. That's how you're going to start your day. It does help finish it. All right. You heard that from a physician. A regular helping of fiber is good for all of us. Let's leave that one right there. Somebody else, same time. Same day, every week, you can count on it. Anybody else? Huh? Coffee, every morning, same time, first thing you do? Are you a bearish before you have your first cup of coffee? No, you're not ever mean, are you, Barb? Jerry? Okay, somebody else? Routine. Pam?
I clean every week on the same day. 3 days a week, I clean different things every week.
So you've got your cleaning regimen, and you're going to clean certain things on certain days.
Yes.
And if you get out of whack,
I don't do that.
It's a bad day.
It is.
Okay. Anybody? All right, Sarah? Okay, so you're a bird watcher early in the morning, every morning, weather permitting. Okay. Okay, sometimes when it's not. Somebody else? Caleb, what you got? Cereal? Do you eat the same cereal every day? What is your brand? Huh? Golden Puffs. Oh, sweet, crunchy corn pops, right? Oh, yeah. That's good for what ails you. Ethan, I see that hand. You can say it. Oh, you pass. Okay. Okay. Don? Prayer time, every Wednesday morning, 6 o'clock. Good one. Routine. Okay, I'm with y'all. I'm guilty. I have an order that I go in every morning in the process of getting ready. I'm not going to give you the order, but it is an order. And should something happen and I miss a step, whew, it's not good. It's not good. I mean, the whiskers have to be cut in the right place in the order. The teeth have to be brushed in the right place in the right order. Everything has to be done in the right order, or else it throws everything out of whack, and you almost need to go back and start over. In fact, you just need to go to bed and try to get back to sleep and start over your day. So when something happens that disrupts our routine, most of us are at the very least thrown off balance for a moment or a day or a season in life, when something has taken away from us the security of that routine. Psalm 46 is a word about those of us who have had our routine snatched away from us. It is a word about times in life when the familiar landmarks, the things that we count on, are taken away. And that's why this is an appropriate passage of scripture that works well in a funeral setting, but it also works well just in life itself. And so listen as I read through it. It begins, and we've sung these words tonight, so many of them, so many great songs have come out of this particular song. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. That's the declaration. That's the testimony upon which everything else in this psalm is going to stand. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the hearts of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride. There's a change, a pronounced change in feeling, in intensity, in energy. There's a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the most dwelling places of the Most High. And God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar. The kingdoms tottered. But he raised his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Another change, another mood, a sense of instruction. Come behold the works of the Lord, who has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots with fire. Cease striving and know that I am God. The old words are, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. We enjoy routine. We enjoy predictability. Oh, we'll say variety is the spice of life. And we think we mean that, but we do not. We like our routines. Some of you go to restaurants in this town and other towns, and they've got 123 things on the menu, and if you went 123 times, you would order the same blessed thing every time you went. I don't blame you. I mean, if you find a good thing, stay with it until they mess you up and then move on to something else. But we like to do things a certain way. There are those of us in this room who over the years, as we have talked about our journeys to the Florida Panhandle, Destin or Pensacola or Panama City, there are people in this room who think that the very best way to get there is to go down I-20, down through Hattiesburg, and then across that way. And then there are those of us who are not convinced and believe that the best way to go is to go over to Shreveport, get on I-49, go all the way to Lafayette, hit I-10, and then go cross country. And it is a safer way, it is a better way. But those people who are convinced that the Mississippi way is the best way are very committed. And they're going to do it every time. They would do it every time if it took them 30 minutes longer. They would do it every time if there were not a decent convenience store between here and Pensacola, because it is the way they have chosen and they're comfortable with it. And those of us who go the other way are the same way. We like our routine, our habits, our patterns. But life isn't that way. And the first part of this psalm, after the declaration that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, the first part of this psalm is an admission. It's a difficult admission, but it is an admission that life itself is extremely unpredictable, the unpredictable nature of life. As much as we enjoy familiarity and predictability and sameness, we have to admit that life rarely allows us protracted stretches of time without a curveball, without something that throws us off of that schedule, without something that disrupts our routine that we are so fond of. In this picture, therefore we will not fear though the earth should change. I really don't know what the psalmist had in mind as he sat and he wrote those words. I don't know what natural phenomenon he might have observed that he could compare to the changes that come in life for an individual or for a nation. I don't know. I will tell you that one of the first times that I really began to wrestle with this psalm personally, it was about the time that Mount St. Helens erupted. Are many of you old enough to remember that? It was one of the most incredible natural things I had ever witnessed on the news in my life. By the end of the time, by the end of the day, they were able to put on one side of the screen the before picture, and on the other side of the screen the after picture. Beautiful green mountain scenery. All of that you would have expected as a part of that mountainous terrain. But then after Mount St. Helens erupted, it looked as if a bomb had gone off. It looked as if some atomic weapon had been utilized, and everything that had been green was now gray. What had been covered with lush flora and fauna now was covered with ash. What had been alive now seemed very much dead, including people. And it happened just like that. It was still the same place. It still had the same address. It still had the same zip code. It was still physically located in exactly the same place, but it was radically changed. Just recently, we celebrated the 15th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina? Was that 17th? Okay, 2005. You would remember that, Miss Joyce, because you were right there in it. 17th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, and those of us who were familiar with the Gulf Coast, the before and the after of that was incredible. To see the force of that water as it swept in and then swept out, to see the devastating effects of the flood, again, the before and after pictures were absolutely unbelievable. And there have been fires have left that same kind of carnage, that same kind of devastation, and tornadoes, hurricanes, obviously they have. But the before and after pictures remind us of life a few minutes ago and life now, life yesterday and life today. And as much as we can pine away for the way things were, and that's what we'll often say, oh, I can't wait till things get back to, they don't ever. Life is permanently changed by experiences that we go through, that we endure, that we choose, or maybe that we don't choose. But life is permanently changed. And I, in thinking about this, there are a number of things that we could talk about. And obviously, there are a few that you can identify with. We are, you know, I don't say this morbidly, but it's just factually, we are one doctor's visit away from a different life. One report, one x-ray, one scan. You know, we always hope for the best. We want good words. Don't worry, everything's good. I love that preamble to the statement, for a man your age. Just say you're in good shape. Don't set me up with for a man your age. And we want to hear the good report, but there are those words. Tumor. Growth. Cancer. You're sitting there minding your own business. Heart attack. Stroke. There are those health situations that, again, we don't invite, but that come with suddenness that change the course of our life. Certainly death does. People become anchors. They become our rocks, our go-to people. They're a part of our network. And then suddenly, whether we've had time to prepare or not, suddenly they're gone from us. And we may find ourselves we had leaned on the old folks, had leaned on the parent, the grandparent, for wisdom, for counsel, for something solid in our life, and all of a sudden they're gone and you become that old person in the family. You become the wise one, the sage, and you feel poorly equipped to be that person. Death. Jobs move us around these days. We are rarely rooted in one place for the entirety of our life, and so the boss can come in or somebody from HR can come in and say, hey, guess what? If you want a job, it's going to be halfway across the world tomorrow. Show up if you'd like. Or they might just come in and say, you know, it's been swell knowing you. Here's a little box. If you'll pack up your stuff, we're going to escort you to your car, and it's been nice working for you. Everything changes. Divorce changes everything. It's never easy, never painless. It just changes life. We could go on and on with the list, but when these things happen, there is a moment where we realize that we are no longer in control. We never were, thought we were, because of that sameness, because of that routine. As long as things are going along, we can have our bowl of shredded wheat or our bowl of corn pops every day. The world's going to keep spinning and we're going to be okay. But the moment it happens, you can't even remember sometimes, what am I supposed to do next? Where do we go from here? How do we work our way through this? Because of the disorienting power of those kinds of calamitous experiences. And if we're not careful, it can also affect our faith. Because we enjoy that consistency, that faithfulness, that predictability of God. And when our lives are good, it's easy to sing, God is so good. But in the midst of this, it is difficult to even say it. I will tell you, I've had a few people that have left this room when we would sing. I remember, Tim, I don't know, that new arrangement of God is so good, that it's a really beautiful arrangement. I remember the first time we sang that, I looked up and I saw somebody going out of the room. And I thought, well, they're, you know, they're phone call, they're not feeling well, they'll be back in a minute. Didn't come back. I saw them later on that week. I said, what gives? I said, well, Sunday morning when we fired up on that, number one, I couldn't sing it because I didn't feel that. And number two, I couldn't even be in the room with all of you singing it, because at that moment, I really was struggling to get my head around whether God really was good or not. She was in a bad place. She had experienced one of those life-changing events that had, I mean, turned her world upside down. And she, well, frankly, didn't want to sing God is so good. You say, well, she should have had the faith to power through. Really? Sometimes it just takes a moment to gather yourself and to figure out where do we go from here. It doesn't mean you've lost your faith. It doesn't mean you're no longer Christian. It means you're real. You're human. And we care. We love. We are invested in. We want security. And we sometimes, unfortunately, find it in our routine and in the sameness of life. And so as the psalmist looked at this calamitous change that had occurred in nature and understood the power of that and how it causes us to be swept off our feet, how it causes us to be uncertain, at least for the moment, about life, he then changes course and reminds us, it is as if he has listened to our heart. We need a place. We need somebody. We need something that we can count on in this moment. We are being rolled around by these circumstances. We are being buffeted by all these things that are happening, and we can't find a place where we can even think clearly. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. Throughout Scripture, God is often represented as a river of life, the water of life. His presence is represented by that kind of a life-giving stream. And there's no question that could have been in the psalmist's mind. But I think at the same time, there is that reality that when you are, man, when life is going fast and you are off balance and it's so noisy that you can't hear yourself think, you can't figure out what's next, you need a place. Sometimes you'll find that place at the expense of people, and you'll say, y'all got to leave me alone. You got to leave me alone. I remember an instance Unfortunately, she wasn't talking to me, and so that was even better. She was talking to somebody else. And it was a bad time. It was a bad moment, and this person was trying to talk to her, and he was trying to give, he thought, wise encouragement, wise counsel, and he was leaned over, and he was speaking in her ear. And I was watching it from across the hallway, and I remember clearly when she kind of backed up and looked at him and said, "Get out of my face." I backed up. I wasn't the one talking, but I didn't want to be next. So I backed up, and I could see in her face, "I need you to shut up. I need a moment. I need some peace and quiet." Unfortunately, in these kind of circumstances, we're not able oftentimes, in fact, the vast majority of the times, we can't call time out and get away. You can't go to a distant island. You can't run to the beach and just listen to the surf as it laps up on the sand. You can't get away and reorient yourself. You're caught in that moment. And so in that moment, in that place, you need that peace, that sense of calm, that sense of assurance, that sense of encouragement that can only come from God's presence. It isn't that we can run away and hide. It isn't that we can close the door and shut out all the noise and reorient ourselves. It is that in that moment we can stop for a moment and recognize that there's a river whose streams make glad the city of God. And God, faithful God, never runs away from us. I like that about Him. The Scripture says very clearly, even when we are faithless, even when we don't know what to do and we may do the wrong thing, our God is going to be faithful. Aren't you glad that He doesn't reciprocate us with faithlessness for our faithlessness? Even when we are faithless, our God is going to be faithful and going to be who He is. And so we can go back to the beginning. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Always, always He will be there. Always He will be waiting for us. Always, always He will be available to us. And the psalmist just wanted this group of people, this group of worshipers, to recognize that in the midst of those tumultuous times of life, God is faithfully being God. But then he gets to the last part. And you know this, that God is not the kind of rescuer that comes sweeping in and against your will grabs you up and extricates you from the moment. You don't wake up the next day in strange surroundings and look around and say, "How did I get here?" That's what you do after you tie one on Saturday night. That is not what happens in your relationship with the Lord. He is not that kind of God who takes over our will, overwhelms, overpowers our will, and directs us even against our will. But He shows Himself to us. He reveals Himself to us and with open arms invites us. "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. But come." And so the psalmist, and this is one of those places where I don't like what the New American Standard does with some of the older language. The psalmist said, "Be still first. Would you be still?" Now the lady said to my friend, "I need you to get out of my face. I need you to be quiet." This is a word for those of us who are frantically trying to fix it, trying to find an answer, trying to find a way out. And our personalities are all different. And for some of us, when we get in a mess, when we get in a place where we know something needs to change, we go into turbo thrust. I mean, we start moving very fast, thinking very fast, trying to find something that's going to work, something that's going to get me out of this, something that's going to resolve this. And before you know it, we are going wide open and we're getting nowhere fast. So I like this. Be still. It's as if God has reached down, and I told you He doesn't overwhelm our will, but I do think there are times when God is able to reach into our life and grab us by our shoulders and not shake us violently. He would never do that. He would just grab us by the shoulders and look us in the eye and say firmly, "Be still. Stop for just a moment." No, stop. And let's look at where we are. "But it's bad, God." We can complain. "But it's bad, God." I know that. But God, I've lost, I know that. But God, it's never going to be the same. I know that. I know that. Just stop for a minute. I'm here. I'm here. Oh, okay. Be still, but then comes the part of our will. I want you to be still and remember, know that I am God. I want you to remember what I've done and where I've been with you. I want you to remember how faithful I have been in your good times of life and how I never walked away from you in the struggles of life. I want you to remember how even when you sinned against me, even when you rebelled against me, I never ever abandoned you. I never turned my back on you. Even when I disciplined you out of love. The author of Hebrews says the Lord disciplines or scourges those whom he loves. There's no anger, there's no hate there, but a loving father. He said, I want you to think back to my pattern. Think back to who I've been. Think back to what I've done in your life. Be still for just a moment. Cease striving and know that I am still God. And all of that that just happened, that looks like a mess, it looks like a pile of broken pieces, it looks like carnage, I want you to understand this, that I, your God, am able to take all of that mess and use it for your good. No. Oh, yeah. Paul got to that place. And we quote it. It's on our refrigerator magazine. And we know that all things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. Whew. I don't know, God, that's pretty bad stuff. Yeah, I know. I know. It hurt. I know. I hate it. Yeah, I know that too. But if you'll just hang on and hold on to me, I'm going to take what you think you would like to run as far as you can away from. I'm going to take all that and I'm going to do something with it that's going to make you better, stronger, wiser, more ready to live today than you were yesterday. Whew. Okay. Okay, God. So we're going to make it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be okay. Yes, we are. Yes, you are. You're going to be different, but you're going to be okay. Life is going to be different, and the routine may be different, but life is going to be okay and beyond okay because God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, you know us. Every one of us sitting in this room, you know that person that's sitting in their home and listening to this worship service tonight, and you know better than anybody our circumstances, the changes that have occurred, the trauma that we might have endured, the pain that has unsettled and realigned our life. You know, Father, the mistakes that we make and the devastation that they bring. You know all of that, and still, you are our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I pray tonight, Father, that you would rescue us from that hard-headedness, that stubbornness that would prevent us from being still and remembering. I pray, God, that you would pull us up out of that pit of self-pity, of despair that we often dig for ourselves when we think we're all alone and nobody else has ever had it like we have. Father, we would be reminded that the stuff of which we've talked about tonight is the stuff of life, of the human experience. And you promise to be with us, to be our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. So tonight, Father, I pray that there would be that person or those folk in this room who would see your hand outstretched to them. I pray that there would be those who would hear your voice that they have run from and muted, would hear your voice as you welcome them back to yourself. Father, we pray that you would use this invitation tonight to accomplish your purpose in us. We ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.